Well, I was just telling Derek and Sharon Gilbert that to try to follow Sharon, I'm done and I'm leaving now, so hopefully you've had a very good time. Actually, just before I get started, what I really do want to do is I want to ask my wife, Nita. You might know her as the Pied Piper of ponies. She's a horse whisperer. She's the light of my life. I want her to come and say hi to you.
Thank you for this opportunity to greet you. I don't normally do this, but I wanted to, and I was excited about it, and I didn't know what to say when I got up here, but something really cool happened to me today. So I'm going to get emotional for just a second, so bear with me, because I'm a girl. All of this talk, you know, apocalypse, DNA change, end of the world, last days, I love it and I hate it. I love it because we know that the redemption draweth nigh.
Right.
And so I'm happy about that. I hate it because what I do love, besides all my little ponies, is I love my kids and my grandkids. I loved them before they were born. I love them before they were born. And I love them even now before they're born. There are more to come. I'm sure there will be more grandkids, and I'm loving them even before they're born. But I also hope for their future. And I know where my hope lies, and I know what our calling is, and we cannot stop at this conference. This is the beginning of what our job is,
right.
And that's to get the word out. So I met a wonderful lady earlier today. Terry, thank you so much for coming back to the table and talking to me for a moment. She made me realize that I am not alone in how I feel, and God has given me an opportunity mid of next year to host a ladies event, and she agreed to pray for me because this is a very difficult subject for emotional women to cover because we just want to either cry or, you know, we want to go home and hug our kids and our grandkids. We want to hope for the future, but we also don't want to be caught without oil in our lamp. It's a very tough challenge, and I know that God has brought me to this to do so. She's going to pray for me. Thank you. And if there's anyone else out there that would like to pray for me, please feel free to. Thank you.
Watch out for your stuff. I'm going to pull this off and hold it just in case we have the same kind of a problem, but I'm such a big bag of wind that probably don't need the microphone anyway. Oh, I have to say, you know, following Jeffrey Ratt and Russ Dizdar and Derek and Sharon Gilbert and Sharon's presentation a moment ago. Now what have I got to do? There's no winning. I'm already on the downside, so I'll just let it fly, I guess. See what I told you I would do, Mr. Cameraman? Hey, I want to say, by the way, to Sam and Alice Miller, who are here and who are running these cameras, and they're doing this just as a gift. I wasn't here earlier. I don't know if we told them thank you, but would you give them a round of applause because we very much appreciate their ministry. One other thing, as I was listening to Sharon Gilbert's presentation, if you have not read her book, The Armageddon Strain, you should do so because you will be amazed how this book was written some years ago, but it is actually unfolding before our eyes right now in terms of how technology has finally caught up to her potential vision of some years ago. It's a scary vision. It's going to scare people like my wife. But maybe it'll also help us to get on our knees and pray about the future and also to get involved. I should tell you that some years ago, following Dr. Willard Cantillon at the Oregon Bethel Park, whatever it was called, old-fashioned family camp meeting, kind of reminds me of having to stand up behind Sharon Gilbert, because his opening line was, "Man is not a transcendental ideation of intraseptic autocathric solidaric redaction, nor an orgasmic individuality of mobilized egresses, nor an otypical voldality of voltronized, transfusiformed differentiation spontaneously race-mated into homogeneous individuality." And I said, "Say what?" he explained shortly thereafter that all he had said was that man is not a process of evolution. And his point was that these people who want to support evolution, whatever, They will do what an old preacher I knew years ago who used to use the term 16-cylinder phraseology. They'll wrap their conversation in all these big, difficult words in order to try to give it the pretense of being scientifically supported or philosophically supported or whatever. And if you can't keep up with the language, then obviously you're the idiot and they're right, so get on board and believe in evolution. And his whole point was, it's all a smokescreen, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we've been hearing about the smokescreen today. Oh, and the first giant catastrophe in today's conference occurred when Sharon got up to speak. I was outside, I came in, and my wife said, "Oh, don't tell the joke. Sharon just told it." I had it all worked out because I was on Prophecy in the News, PID last week. And Derek reminded me of this joke, you know, the transhumanists that go up before heaven and say, "We can make a better man than you can." And God says, "You're going to have to get your own dirt." Evidently, you told it. Yes. I can't tell it. But I have an alternative. A little girl goes to her daddy. You always have to have a backup plan in case there's a Sharon Gilbert in the audience. And she says, "Daddy, where did people come from?" And the daddy says, "Well, a long time ago, God made Adam and Eve. He made man in his image, and Adam and Eve began having babies, and before you know it, here's all the human race." So she waited a couple of days, and she went to her mommy. And she said, "Mommy, where did people come from?" And the mommy said, "Well, a long time ago, there were monkeys, and people evolved from the monkeys." Well, that confused her. So she went back to her daddy, and she said, "Daddy, you said that God made man in his image and that that's where everybody came from. Mommy says that they descended from the apes." And he said, "Well, it's simple, honey. I was telling you about my side of the family and she was telling you about hers." Oh, after today, I don't care. But you almost ruined everything for me, so, boy. But now, the funny thing about that is, that's not really quite so funny, is that seriously, folks, transhumanism intends to blend monkeys, apes, synthetic life forms with humanity before the end of this century. And that is a fact. That's not just a fringe fact. That's a National Science Foundation report fact. That's a DARPA fact. That's a U.S. intelligence fact. That's a JASON's, the highest think tank at the U.S. Pentagon fact. And many of them are pointing towards the year 2012, but maybe we'll get to that in just a moment. It is not fringe, in other words. In leading think tanks around the world, Dr. Leon Cass, the former chairman of the President's Council on Bioethics, he says, in think tanks and laboratories around the world, right now the groundwork is being written. The design, if you will, is being drafted, by which the rest of us are going to get in line or get out of the way or potentially be considered the enemies of progress. And I may say something about that in a few minutes too, if you've been following anything over at Raiders News Network and some of the attacks upon me recently, but maybe we'll talk about that in just a moment. I would venture to say that right here in Ohio, and oh, by the way, I was a preacher for 25 years, and what my body is wanting to do is walk across the stage, and you know, but I'm trying to have pity upon the poor cameraman and stay here. He's telling me he don't care, but he does not know the speed he would need on that camera to keep up with me. I mean, I was an old-fashioned preacher of the Russ Dizdar type. You know, we get to go and we leap pretty high and shout pretty loud, but it's the message at the end of the day that matters, right, Russ? I would venture to say that right here in Ohio, the average Ohioan has no clue. Now, maybe inside these walls you do, but in this state, most of them do not know that in 2006, right here in Ohio, Case Law School in Cleveland, Ohio, was the recipient of a $773,000 Department of Health, the largest U.S. Agency that gives grants for research related to health issues, received $773,000. In fact, I have their press release right here. This is from Case Law School. Case Law School received $773,000 NIH grant to develop guidelines for what? For genetic enhancement research. You can go to our website and download that press release. The whole purpose behind the $773,000 grant was for a 24-month period of time for Professor Maxwell Melman, who is the professor of bioethics at Case Law School, to lead a team of scientists, researchers, and also persons who have an interest in government policy over a 24-month period of time to do one thing only: to establish the guidelines that will be used in setting public policy, that is, in other words, law, by which all of us will live, that will regulate the next step in human evolution, human enhancement. That happened right here, 2006. Well, in 2009, just last year, the 24-month research period was over. Professor Melman, and if you read this, and I won't take time to read it to you, they talk about using human subjects during this 24-month period of time. So I had set back, bated breath. I wanted to know, in what way do you use human subjects in experiments for establishing guidelines that will be used for setting public policy with regard to human enhancement as the next step in human evolution? I wanted to know. I'm a taxpayer. This was a taxpayer-funded study. You paid for it. I wanted to know, how were humans used? Well, there was no disclosure yet on how they were used, but here's what I noticed, that immediately when it was finished being funded, Professor Melman began traveling the United States, going to different universities in the United States, giving these two university lectures. Number one, directed evolution. Sharon, directed evolution, public policy and enhancement. And the second lecture, transhumanism and the future of democracy. And if you think I'm kidding you, you can go to Arizona State University, you can go to Google, you can type in Professor Melman's name and type in these titles, and you can actually go and download the audios where at different universities he's giving these lectures. I went and listened to them myself. I was amazed in one of them where he talks about how, yes, human enhancement may in fact lead to an extinction level event. Yes, it may lead to the eradication of all life on earth, but we're going to do it anyway. And that was really his position. Besides those who are in Ohio, I would venture to say that very few Americans are aware that just this last year, in 2009, in California, there was a House Foreign Affairs Committee hearing. It was chaired by Democrat Brad Sherman. Brad Sherman was picked, by the way, to chair this series of hearings because of his expertise in the spread of weapons of mass destruction among terrorists. Well, what was Brad Sherman, this expert, in weapons of mass destruction among terrorists? What meeting was he chairing? What was these House Foreign Affairs Committee hearings all about? Mark Stenzel, who is a writer for the Congressional Quarterly, attended the HFA hearings. He came back. You can Google his article. He wrote an article for CQ, for Congressional Quarterly, called Genes Without Borders, in which he described attending a series of government hearings in which he said, hey, Rob Skiba is a filmmaker. He's working on a series right now. He's got the pilot, I think, is being made. He's made the trailer to sell it to whoever the buyers are in Hollywood or television or elsewhere. The film is called Seed. Go to Google, type it in, find it, go there, watch the trailer. If you can support this project, do so. But hey, Rob, at the HFA hearing, CQ writer Mark Stenzel made us aware of, he said it was more like listening to a Hollywood pitch for a sci-fi movie than it was a sober discussion of scientific reality, with its descriptions by government officials of near future horizon superhumans, super animals, and super intelligence that will become a lethal force against which we are not prepared. Well, just when I was packing up to leave on this trip, have you seen this? The Global Governance 2025 at a Critical Juncture. Have you seen this report? Go to our website, Forbidden Gate, singular, not plural. I know, the book's Forbidden Gates, plural. The website's only Forbidden Gate. Sorry. Went to get the domain and somebody else already owned it. Checked to make sure first it wasn't a porn site, and it wasn't, so we went ahead with ForbiddenGate.com. Wouldn't want any confusion there about how exciting our next book is. You'll find a link there where you can download this. This came out this week. This is September 2010. Came out this week. This report by the United States intelligence community and by the European intelligence community. You know what's terrible is you're way over there. I have to have glasses on. When I'm close, can't have glasses on. I want to read you just a part of this. Go and download this. Read the whole thing for yourself, because the whole report is on global governance. And what they're talking about are the various issues, the causal agents, if you will, that are pushing us toward a global government. U.S. intelligence, European intelligence community, just now published, September 2010. But go to page 35 and note where they say this. No forum currently exists for dealing comprehensively across the scientific community, industry, and governments on measures needed to diminish the risks posed by the biotechnology revolution. Now, what are the risks? What exactly do they mean? Well, they certainly do mean some of what Sharon Gilbert was talking about, the potential for terrorists to get their hands on living biological entities, the remake of a mouse pox or something else that they could release into dense community populations that could literally become a black death. They do mean all of that, and there are security agents right now that are staying up at night afraid of the very fact that we haven't yet had somebody buy one of your sequencing machines. Well, you, I don't think you're selling them. But in any case, but what were they talking about? What is their fear? What is the fear of American intelligence, European intelligence, when talking about biotechnology as one of those things that could push us suddenly into the need for a global government? Here's what they say, 35. I've dropped down only a half of one paragraph. In addition, biotechnology, which the OECD thinks will potentially boost the GDPs of its members, listen, can drive new forms of human behavior and association, creating profound cross-cultural ethical questions that will increasingly become politically contentious. Few experts believe that current governance instruments are adequate for these challenges. Then they give an example. For example, direct modification of DNA at fertilization, now we're talking about germline engineering, is widely researched with the goal of removing defective genes, in other words, our own form of eugenics. However, discussions of future capabilities open the possibility for designing humans with unique physical, emotional, or cognitive abilities, end quotes. Amazing, huh? U.S. intelligence, European intelligence, providing what? This is an 85-page report. You can download and read for yourself. Go to page 35 to read the quote that I was just making. But quoting what causes could suddenly set in motion the need for a global government, and here's human enhancement. The same thing that the HFA hearings in California were saying, that we are on the cusp of something we cannot stop, because our enemies, this is what the Jasons are saying, this is what DARPA is saying, this is what the U.S. Air Force is saying, our enemies will develop this technology ahead of us. Go to Wired Magazine just to get a glimpse and read the article called Jason's Fear, Brain Modified Foes, and how the Wired Magazine got a leaked document from the Pentagon, in which the leading think tank at the Pentagon is saying this technology is getting out of the box. It's already starting. They're already doing it. You know, I haven't seen the movie, but the movie Splice, have any of you seen that movie? I did a show with Steve Quayle recently. He's telling me all about the movie Splice. Part human, part animal creature, but something happens. It suddenly starts mutating. It becomes something else. It grows wings. It becomes what? Russ? Demonic? Suddenly it's turning into a giant, the Nephilim, the spirit of the offspring, and now we've opened a gateway through our technology. Well, but our own leading security experts are saying, yeah, blah, 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 can't help it. Other people around the world, China, the Soviet Union, anybody who can develop this technology is developing it right now. We are in a position, the Jasons believe that this is the next arms race. Super soldier technology and many other ramifications of weaponized biology is the next curve, if you will, taking us where we're going to go. Well, to put it on a very practical platform, am I talking too fast? Am I talking too loud? Am I talking too stupid? Okay. Because all of the above, when you're an old preacher, can happen at any moment. And you have to get somehow back, if you can. You get on a pig trail and it's, where am I? Oh, Lord, help me. Birkbeck Law School. And I haven't looked in my notes in so long that I don't think I know where I'm at anymore, so hopefully that's okay too. Birkbeck Law School is one of the leading crime scene investigation schools in the world. Out of the UK. They put out a press release 24 months ago in which they said on this very practical premise that in the not too distant future they're going to have to develop new classes. Guess what for? Analyzing crime scenes that are the result of human non-humans, that are the result of enhanced humans, because nothing we know about forensics or profiling. You know how they go into a crime scene, they do all the, you know, everything it is they do. I don't even watch CSI, the television movie, so I really can't explain it. Shouldn't try. But they go in and they do all that they do, and you know, they come out of it. Okay, we're looking for a male, and he's 25 to 35 years of age. He's probably of an affluent community, whatever. So they have rules that have been developed over 200 years or more, in which they've learned to analyze a crime scene. And now what Birkbeck Law School is saying, throw it all out the door. Because if we are dealing with a crime scene that is, let's say, something that was perpetrated by a serial rapist who is part wolf, we're dealing with a werewolf. That sounds insane. That's what they were saying. We wouldn't have a clue. We would not know. This thing might have a bloodlust for human blood, like an animal might, in ways that we simply cannot possibly comprehend. Is that sci-fi? No, it's exactly where we're going. Let me move quickly so I don't get too far behind. If you've been paying any attention to Reuters News Network, the National Science Foundation report, did any of you see any of this posted at Reuters News Network where it said, Tom Horn is an extremist pig who would make the Unabomber proud. Did you see that? Well, a few of you did. Well, for those of you that didn't, which is apparently the majority, here's what happened. I put out a press release, and it was simply called Open Letter to Christian Leaders on Biotechnology and the Future of Man. Because I have to tell you, here's what my passion is. What is driving me on this? I want the Christian community to get involved in this discussion on transhumanism in particular, but even in the genetic sciences before it is too late. People just like you, people just like those you have heard speak here today, I want those numbers to swell. Why? Because we're going to lose this battle and very fast. Because the rules, the guidelines are being determined right now by pro-transhumanist think tanks. And that's from within the government, from within the military, from within academia. They are setting the rules right now by which all of us, your children and your grandchildren, are going to live. And every one of them, to no exception, see the transhumanist idea. Oh, what is transhumanism? Did I forget to say? Transhumanism, you could go all the way back to Gilgamesh, those who want to become gods. You could go to the Enlightenment era. But when I speak of transhumanism, I'm simply talking about a modern cultural movement today that is made up of people all across the world who believe that we now have it within our power to use technology to advance human evolution, rewrite our genetics, cybernetically enhance ourselves, make a better version of human 2.0 than what God made. The technology is here, so they believe we no longer need to wait on the daunting task of natural evolution. Who needs a million years of evolution when we can get it all in one day? Woohoo! That's what they're saying. Of course, I'm like Ian Fleming, or Ian Malcolm, I guess his name was, in Jurassic Park, being chased down the road by a giant Tyrannosaurus man-eating Rex saying, "Who thought this was a good idea?" You know. So I put out an open letter, and it went across the newswire. Got picked up by Wired magazine. A lot of others picked it up. Well, pretty soon, like the next day, the number one transhumanist blog, Accelerating Futures, which is operated by a man by the name of Michael Anisimov. Michael is a co-coordinator for the Singularity Summit. Have you heard of that? Very connected, if you will, at the hip with Ray Kurzweil, Aubrey de Grey, all the leading transhumanists. So he's part of them, but this is his blog. So he puts up a piece of that article, went out and did a little homework and found some YouTubes of me recently down in Portland with Alex Ansari doing his show Outside the Box on transhumanism, put that on the top of his website. Went and found the Forbidden Gates. Have you seen the book trailer? Some guy's injecting nanobots in him and becoming demonic. They really didn't like that. Put that on the top of the website too, just for good order. Well, pretty soon all over Accelerating Futures, the most vitriolic, terrible, hate-filled things were being said about me by people who don't know me from Adam. They don't know where I come from. They don't know what motivates me. They don't know my logic. They don't know my temperament or spirit or anything else. But they're over there saying they hope I get cancer and die. Why? What was my crimes against humanity? I had asked Christians to read the NSF report and other reports and become aware of what is happening, what your taxpayers are paying for, or your dollars are paying for. Become aware of it. Get involved in the debate. Well, they hated that. Well, then by the next day, somehow, Patrick Lynn, who is the co-author of the new National Science Foundation report, Ethics of Human Enhancement, 25 Questions and Answers, another taxpayer-funded report that just came out, he found out about it. Well, he went over to the IET. Now, this is the world's leading online transhumanist think tank. So he posts this article over there. The name of the article is Wrestling with Pigs. So I opened the article because somebody sent it to me and said, "Hey, you're in the spotlight at the IEET." And it's all about my call for Christians. And he didn't like the fact that I had told Christians, get the NSF report. Don't just read the NSF report. Look at the people who are operating behind it. Look at their organizations. What groups they belong, what seats they hold, what institutions they are part of, because it is a who's who of transhumanist dreamers worldwide. Well, Patrick did not like that. He didn't like it because he publicly tries to say he's not a transhumanist, though he holds a seat at the IEET, but he will say he's not a transhumanist. Okay, I give him a break. He's not a transhumanist. He's just a guy who's very sympathetic to the transhumanist cause. I don't care. I'm saying, get this, read it. Well, he didn't like it. And he furthermore, and he's talking about you as much as he's talking about me, because he makes the point over there at the IET that they had found somewhere a Lutheran pastor who was fine with human transhumanism. It's okay, cool, might be the fulfillment of God's will for our lives. Well, that kind of a guy, he says, welcome in. But like me and you, conservatives who might see this as an affront to the divine order, and at a minimum, as the gateway to a biological nightmare, who have concerns about this and who want a real, true, open forum in the public, in the debate. Let's get this on television. Let's get it in universities. Let's get both sides of the issues. Let's get conservative bioethicists, men like Francis Fukuyama and others, and Sharon for that matter. Let's put them up on the stage and let's have this debate. Yeah. I nominate Sharon. How about you? Well, they didn't like that. They don't like that. And the language was so loaded. When you read it, you'll see what I mean, because he tried to be clever, but he's weaving in words like, you know, there's this side of Christianity, but those, that other side. And he uses loaded words like extremists. He actually says those people who would make Ted Kaczynski, the Unabomber, proud. So now all of a sudden you're being stereotyped. If you're a conservative, and especially if you believe in biblical prophecy, you are a potential terrorist. You're not invited to this discussion. You're not to be part of this. Well, you know what? I say forget that. I am invited. I'm coming whether you want me or not. And I'm bringing as many as I can bring with me, and we're going to talk about this issue in a public forum. Well, he hated that. You know what was great, though? Let me tell you something about you folks. Within a 2 or 3 day period, I went to YouTube and I pulled down, they had put the video that Joe and the rest of his team made. By the way, you met my wife, but there is the wild man of the Ozarks, the most guitar assassinating crazy man you've ever met in your life. Serving as my slave, as it should be. Well, I thought I had already introduced you to my wife. By the way, at my house, when you open up the dictionary and you read better half, there's a picture of her in there. All right. Of course, she's the one that pasted it in there, but it's in there. How much time do I have?
Don't worry about it. Forever.
Yeah. Yeah, you say that now. Patrick Lynn, co-author of the National Science Foundation report, tries to take me to task. Well, guess what happened? They posted our YouTube video over there that Joe made. I went over there after 3 days. I went to YouTube and dropped the window down and looked down to see where the traffic was coming from. They had had 200 plays from their website. News with Views had had 800 plays from their website. Raiders News Network had had 10,000 plays from its website. And they had to shut down the comment section at the IET. If you think I'm kidding, you go there and pull down to the bottom and look at it. And they said, we had to shut down this section, just too many comments. And plus, we didn't like some of those comments that were talking about how we're all going to burn in hell. There probably was one that said that and 50 others that were making good rational sense about, look, even Ian Malcolm from Jurassic Park, he's not a Christian. He's a scientist that subscribes to the chaos theory. He's saying God didn't allow for it, but neither did natural evolution. And what we are doing now has no precedent. And we are tinkering with biological forces that have the potential to annihilate mankind in a single hour. So doesn't somebody somewhere think that bioconservatives ought to be involved in this discussion? Well, absolutely yes. Well, anyway, took issue, said that it wasn't fair. He's not a transhumanist. Well, there goes the glasses. So let me read you what he says. This is his words, co-author, National Science Foundation. And you can tell me if you think I'll get him. I got one guy over there he should have ran right over here and got him. Thank you, sir. Yeah, I'm going to pay for it later, I got to tell you. It's fun now, payday later. Here's what he says. This is the start of the brand new National Science Foundation Ethics of Human Enhancement, 25 questions and answers, and they tell you that they've written this because the discussion has to start now to set the guidelines by which we are going to set national policy, law. How will the Constitution, how will the Bill of Laws be extended to a man who's part human, who's part monkey? How much has to be human for the Bill of Rights to extend to him? At what point does he no longer become human? The Jews are weighing in on this just to show how insane the ethics behind where we're going now is. And they're saying, well, if he's part cow, how much could be cow before we could offer him as a sacrifice? But the point that they're making is there is no way. I mean, once you cross this boundary, there is no going back. But we're crossing the boundary anyway. Well, here's what Mr. Patrick Lynn says. This is your taxpayer-funded reports. You might want to know what you paid for. Quote, "It is not just the world around us that we desire to change. Since the beginning of history, we also have wanted to become more than human, to become homo superior, from the godlike command of Gilgamesh to the lofty ambitions of Icarus, to the preternatural strength of Beowulf, to the mythical skills of Shaolin monks, and to various shamans and shapeshifters," Russ, "shapeshifters throughout the world's history, we have dreamt and still dream of transforming ourselves to overcome our all-too-human limitations." Those are the opening lines to the National Science Foundation report. He says this, "With ongoing work to unravel the mysteries of our minds and bodies, coupled with the art and science of emerging technologies, we are near the start of the human enhancement revolution." Well, ladies and gentlemen, he's telling the truth. As a matter of fact, as I was doing research on this for the last 15 years, but very intently over the last 4 or 5 years, and then specifically over the last couple of years, leading towards the writing of Apollyon Rising 2012, but more specifically this new book, Forbidden Gates, I found that almost to a man, almost to a letter, every one of these reports are pointing to the year 2012, which was very astonishing to me that these military, I printed it here just before I left because I can never think of his name. I do have it. Counterterrorism Czar Richard Clark. Oh, thank you. That's his job. Counterterrorism Czar Richard Clark in his book Breakpoint. Have you read it? Year 2012 begins the quickening, the unfolding of human enhancement, and it starts. The singularity arrives, and the human enhancement revolution begins in earnest, and most of the world is very, very excited about it. We all get to be more powerful, we're going to live longer, we're going to do all these things, we can see into other dimensions. But you know what he also says in Breakpoint? That those who are conservative and who are against the human enhancement revolution are stereotyped as terrorists, and we are locked away. There is an ideological war that is unfolding right now for the mind of this generation. And ladies and gentlemen, we get involved with this or we don't. And if we don't, we abdicate to those types of visionaries our future and the future of our children. The good news is there was a reason why there was 10,000 downloads from Raiders News Network and 200 from the IET, because we outnumber them by the hundreds of thousands. We don't have to let them define for us what our future will be. Now, I should also tell you that I am not, I'm not a neo-Luddite. I'm not against technological progression. I'm not. Look here, I've already been enhanced. But to the extent that we start talking about redefining what it means to be a human, blending our genetics with animals and plant life and other types of things, somewhere you have to draw a line. Or at least in my mind, you do. And I believe that there is wisdom that God has that we don't have. Why did God order each kind to reproduce after its own kind? What does he know that we don't know? Well, a great deal, I'm sure of that. Huh? Yeah. You're like that guy, you know, the remake of The Fly. And he's building a transporter, and he gets in it, and he's going to move from here to there. And during a transportation process, he accidentally has his DNA integrated with a normal housefly. Well, he comes out on the other side, and a few days later, man, he starts becoming the transhumanist dream come true. Sexual proclivities of an African lion can outrun everybody, stronger, faster. But then something else starts happening. And that's that unknown. The unknown, where you start mutating into a horrific monster and you have to be destroyed. Those are very, very real possibilities. Have you seen the movie I Am Legend? And if you watch it, there's a Sharon, but an unsaved Sharon Gilbert, right in the very beginning of it, a geneticist, an unsaved one though. And she's saying, we have found the cure to cancer. And it turns out the cure to cancer is a vaccine that is a concoction of human and animal genetics. The reason it can cure cancer is because some animals, I guess, have a great resilience to cancer. So they figure out some way to blend human and animal genetics. They create a vaccine. All the world celebrates. Everybody's inoculated. Nobody has cancer. Then the scene goes dark. Then the scene opens up and almost all life on Earth is annihilated. Why? Because the human form of rabies developed as a result of crossing over a barrier that God in his infinite wisdom had put in place, and it wipes out most all humanity. So I trust in God. I'm a biblical literalist, and I have real issues with some of the place we're going. Am I getting offline? Off track? Let me just read you a couple of things that they say here in the NSF, which you paid for. As examples of emerging technologies in the last year or so, a couple imaginative inventions in particular among many are closing the gap. Even more between science fiction and the real world, scientists have conceptualized a touch display designed to be implanted just under the skin that would activate special tattoo ink on one's arm to form images such as telephone number keys to punch or even to watch a video. Together with ever-shrinking computer devices, we appear to be moving closer to cybernetic organisms or cyborgs, that is, where machines are integrated with our bodies. Does this sound prophetic to anybody but me? Really? I mean, am I just a radical who would make Ted Kaczynski, the Unabomber, proud? Yeah, let's go terrorize the transhumanists. You can read this for yourself. Here's another quick clip. Now, are these people channeling the Nomo? We can also envision the possibility that prosthetic flippers designed today for dolphins, along with artificial gills, might be requested by humans who want to transform into an aquatic animal. Your tax dollars at work. All right, so finally, here's what he says. Finally, this is the pay dirt. Finally, we will mention here the related persistent concern that we are playing God with world-changing technologies, which is presumably bad, he says sarcastically. But what exactly counts as playing God? And why is that morally wrong? I.e., where exactly is the proscription in religious scripture not to play God? We do not wish to be mired. This is what it says. We do not wish to be mired in such theological issues, as important as they are to theists. Well, there it is. But I wish to engage them in it anyway. And I'll tell you something, there's very good reasons why these folks don't want people like me and you involved in this. They got a really small taste of this actually back in 2002 and 2003. Do you remember when Admiral John Poindexter was the head of the DARPA Information Awareness Office? And you remember there was a series of flaps. Most of the public wasn't even aware of what was going on, in which he got canned. Remember all that? Well, it was because the Senate Appropriations Committee, during some issues, started looking into DARPA. And as they were looking into how money was flowing into DARPA and what it was being used for, they were astonished to find unstoppable mutations, super soldiers whose DNA had already been reconstructed this over a decade ago, who could communicate by thought alone, already on the drawing board, already being funded in 2002. Now, Professor Joel Goru, who was an investigative reporter for the Washington Post at that time, and by the way, who wrote the book Radical Evolution, you should get it. It's not written from a Christian or transhumanist point of view. It's simply research into what was going on. It was written in 2005, but it is one of the best books out there to lead you to the multiple think tanks, reports, government reports, what's going on in different appropriation committees. It is a fantastic piece of investigative journalism. But here's a little excerpt that he gives us on what happened during Poindexter's day. The staffers, he's talking about the Senate Appropriations Committee, the staffers went down the list of DARPA projects, found the ones with titles that sounded frighteningly as though they involved the creation of a master race of superhumans, and zeroed out their budgets from the Defense Appropriations Bill. There is scant evidence they, talking about the staffers, knew much, if anything, about these projects, but we will probably never know the details, because significant people are determined that the whole affair be forever shrouded in mystery. The levels of secrecy were remarkable, even for DARPA. They were astounding by the standards of the notoriously leaky Senate. Even insiders said it was hard to get a feel for what the facts really were. It took months of reporting and questioning, poking and prodding, even to get a formal no comment, either from the leadership of the Senate Appropriations Committee or from Anthony J. Tether, who was, of course, the director of DARPA at that time. A careful study, now this is interesting, a careful study of DARPA's programs a year later, however, showed little change. Considerable, creative, budgetary maneuvering had ensued. The P's of quite a few programs now reside under new, much better camouflaged shells. One manager told me it didn't stop anything. We'll just be smarter about how we position things. Meanwhile, he said, new human enhancement programs are in the pipeline as bold or bolder than the ones that preceded them. Well, I can tell you, after 2 years of research, that's an understatement. In fact, as one of the speakers pointed out earlier, when you look at what you can find, especially as it regards the military and other members of the government who work to appropriate funding towards especially top secret issues, what they call SAPOC. These are SAPs. These are waived programs that do not have to go before congressional scrutiny. You wonder sometimes, why in the military did I just have to pay $1,875 for a hammer? Well, there's a reason. Because there's vast amounts of money that are going into black budgets. These are beyond congressional review. And so when you see in the public, if you can go to Wired Magazine like I did recently, another leaked document, DARPA themselves may have leaked it as a part of the whole propaganda system, where they were introducing, these cutesy little names, the Batman and Robin Project. Don't you love those acronyms? Batman, the Biochronicity Project. Robin, the Robustness Project. Woo! Just makes me want to support it. I get tingly all over. But we copied the pages out of DARPA's project and put it inside Forbidden Gates, and you'll find out what they're really talking about is taking control of nature, taking control of biological, creating whole cloth biological entities that can be used in terms of warfare. Not just biological weapons like a plague or whatever. For instance, it's in this year's budget, by the way. The 2011 DARPA's presidential budget, which has gone to the Hill, has pages we photocopied for you in Forbidden Gates, out of their budget, for the creation of things like biodesign. Well, what is biodesign? All we know is it's living, breathing creatures, but they're not just any kind of living, breathing creatures. They're immortal. They want to know how to get around cellular death. They want to know how to create immortal, living, breathing creatures with military application. And furthermore, they're so concerned about what they're already trying to unleash from Pandora's box, they want a kill switch put in it, just in case it gets control and comes after us. Or our enemies capture it and they go to use it against us, so they want to be able to throw some kind of a switch. This is in the 2011 DARPA budget. There's even lines in there where it very openly talks about editing soldiers' DNA. So we have not stopped anything. We are full speed ahead. And if a person like me, a researcher like me, can find this kind of evidence, then imagine, ladies and gentlemen, how far 20, 30, 40 years ahead of our knowledge the military actually is in the construction of a new kind of proto-human. And they want it to be immortal. It can't be killed. Well, I seem to remember when this happened once before. And what's amazing is how even in the transhumanist camp, transhumanists themselves, they would never say it like I would, but there's, you know, you ever seen those cartoons, the devil's over here whispering in the ear and a little angel over here with, you can see some of these transhumanists are amazing. They dance all around it, but if they were honest, they'd say, this scares me to death. Where we're going now could be the end of all mankind. But let's, how much time do I have? I'll try, honestly, I will try to go fast. Let me talk about just for a second the spiritual side, then we'll go to the prophetic side. Let me divide it. Because within transhumanism, there are also those who believe that this is not just biological matter we're tinkering with here. They honestly believe that as we transform Homo sapiens, we also are opening a gate to something they're unsure of, Russ. But they want to go there anyway. They want to make contact. What's driving them? What's motivating them? To wrestle with their fears. To say, this terrifies me. But I must. I have to do it. I'll tell you what, I challenge you. Go to Nick Bostrom, one of the leading transhumanist experts in the world. He is one of the grandfathers of transhumanism. Go to nickbostrom.com. He earned his prestigious seat at Oxford University, writing his thesis on transhumanist values. And go there, and one of the nice things about Professor Bostrom is he's been willing to put what he writes out there for anybody to read, where most of them, they'll run away from what they write, hide from it, try to keep it, you know, in secret and in private corridors. At least he's putting it out there. And pull down his transhumanist values and open the page. And go down through there and read his descriptions of why, first of all, why we are going towards human enhancement, whether you like it or not. Secondly, what the benefits of humanity might be. But then find great interest when you get down to where he starts talking about merging ourselves with animals. And he has a large rectangle there. And he uses the same rectangle when he gives lectures at the Transvision conferences, you know, every year and at different universities. Large rectangle. And in the small corner of this rectangle, he draws a circle. Now, the rectangle represents all possible modes of perception. Pastor Russ often talks about other areas of perception. Mike Bennett at your conference last year talked about using DMT, mind-altering drugs, in order to open modes of perception into supernatural realities like shamans have done for thousands of years to make contact with the spirit world. But now, Professor Bostrom thinks transhumanism could provide a more stable pathway, a more permanent pathway. We will merge ourselves with animals. And so he draws a circle in the rectangle, and he says this small circle in this giant rectangle represents the modes of perception that we humans have today, those that were given to us by the big meanie God who won't let us see into these other areas of perception. So we have taste and seeing and sight and smelling and whatever. But then he draws a larger circle around that circle. It encompasses all that is man, but it extends further into these modes of perception, and this is called the animal kingdom. And he writes about how animals, they can navigate using sonar. They can see into areas of the light spectrum that we cannot see into. They seem to, you know, migrate. What are they doing? Are they reading the vibrations of the earth or something when they move out of a particular area before an earthquake comes? They can hear at higher decibels. They can fly using sonar like bats. They can navigate undersea in the water. They can do all these things, and we want to be able to do that. That's why it's in the NSF report. We want to become the NOMO. We want to become alien hybrids that can float around under the sea. But before I get off my task, back to Nick Bostrom. And so he talks about all that. Then he draws a larger circle around that. This encompasses all that is man, all that is animal, but now we're talking about transhumans, something that is part animal, part human, and even part synthetic creations. And we will open new modes of perception that are beyond our visible constraints right now, or other sensory modalities that we may not as yet even understand. And then finally, of course, en route to becoming post-human, eventually we will be post-humans, something so radically different than what humans are today as to no longer even be considered to be a human, and we will have the wonders of all of these various modes of perception. Well, when reading his thesis some years ago, I could not help but think of Balaam riding down the road, kicking his donkey. What is up with this stupid animal? He won't get back on the road. Well, the donkey could see something he couldn't see. Pretty big angel standing in the road with a sword. You might not want to go running at him. And that's one illustration. There's been other research that's been done that leads us to believe that animals often see things or somehow are aware of what we would think of as the spirit world, the supernatural realm. Transhumanists like that. Maybe get in contact with some pretty cool entities there that are just beyond our range. Terence McKenna, who was the scientist who was the originator of time wave theory and novelty theory, and who experimented with DMT and other psychoactive mind-expanding drugs and made contact with the grays and the ETs and all the rest of them, but then would have to come down off his high and come back to this reality, speculated that in the very near future, via human enhancement, we won't no longer need these psychoactive drugs because we'll alter our brains to put ourselves in contact. There is this an extraordinary interest. By the way, if you think I'm exaggerating, go to Arizona State University. Go to their website. You'll see a tab there called the SOFIA Project. At Arizona State University, the Templeton Foundation has been paying for a long series of mostly pro-transhumanist lectures on transhumanism and religion and the future of democracy. Well, guess what? As a result of these conversations and the Nick Bostrom types talking about, you know, kind of dancing around because they sure don't want to use language that then us Christians would come along and say, hang on, let me get you Russ Dizdar's email real quick. They don't want to hear about it. But at Arizona State University, some of the lecture givers, the presenters there, and some of the students have been saying, but wait a minute. Professor Guru says that we won't just change ourselves biologically, we will literally rewrite our souls. We will change ourselves spiritually. And if there is something else there, regardless of what religion you are, these students are asking, do we really want to just, you know, do we want this forbidden gate? Do we want this open? And so now, Arizona State University, last year, 2009, launched a brand new project called the SOFIA Project. Go there and click on it and amaze yourself. Because what they want to do is they want to confirm and make contact with the other side. This is Arizona State University. And they even list what they want to confirm communication and or make contact with. Aliens, angels, demons, the spirits of dead humans, Gaia, God, a universal mind, whatever it is, whatever's there, we want to figure out a way to get to it. Now, does that sound like a good idea? But there is a spiritual side. I'm going to go very quickly. There's also a prophetic side. And this too is shared by transhumanists. Not just old time preachers like Tom Horn. And to prepare myself for writing Forbidden Gates, I finally made myself do something that I had not done. I went back and I read. And now I was familiar with Hugo de Garis's theories. And I'd actually done shows and documentary films where I talked about a series, but I never had actually sat down and read the book cover to cover. So in preparation for this, I went and I had my wife, the beautiful one herself back there, the Pied Piper of Ponydom. I had her, through Amazon, order me Hugo de Garis's book, The Artelect Wars, Cosmos versus Terrans. Well, if you want to see a transhumanist who is trying as hard as he can not to be an Old Testament prophet, get that book and read it. Because I'm telling you, he's a singularitarian, By the way, I would not call myself a singularitarian, but I believe in the coming singularity. I believe the Lord should tarry in the not too distant future, very near, probably closer than we can imagine. There's going to come a moment. Technological singularity is going to occur in one day in which an artificial mind is going to come online. We're going to create it. We're working hard to create it right now. We've got laboratories around the world and the brightest minds in the world trying to create a godlike synthetic intelligence. And Hugo de Garis was one of the leading artificial brain designers in the world all of his adult life. But when you read what he talks about, he talks about how he goes to bed at night and he has these euphoric feelings that he's just, he says it, he uses this kind of language, it is a religious experience to dream of this massively godlike intelligence that we are just on the very, we're on the cusp right now of creating. And it will be, according to both him, Kurzweil, and all the rest, trillions of times more smarter than our best minds on earth, and more fast and faster. Trillions of times. In fact, what they compare it to, us trying to communicate with this thing the day after it comes online would be like a rock trying to communicate with you. Simply no possible way. And they use the term singularity because if you know anything about physics, when you are approaching the event horizon in physics of a dark hole, a black hole, as you approach the event horizon, you cross through to the singularity, even physics changes. Nothing we understand whatsoever about physical rules apply any longer. Technological singularity will be the same thing. In one day, a mind comes online, and by the next day, we are all standing at a standstill waiting to see what this super intelligence is going to demand of us. Well, what Hugo de Garis would go to bed at night having these euphoric dreams. You like how I jump right back in that? He'd go to bed at night having these euphoric dreams about this God he's going to create. But then what he says is 2-3 o'clock in the morning. He is jerked from sleep by a horrific nightmare in which he sees a sea of blood and chaos and all of humanity annihilated as a result of the creation of these artificial intelligences. And so he goes back and forth. He becomes schizophrenic. I'm a Cosmos. I'm a Terran. I'm a Cosmos. I'm a Terran. I want to be a Cosmos. I think I'm a Terran. Finally, it comes down, I'm a Cosmos, which is a transhuman, which believes that ultimately in the end, we will have the power to do it. We have to do it. We will do it. And the potential benefits outweigh the risks. And by the way, to give you a fast clue on his terminology, artelect is a word of his making. It means artificial intellect, instead of just simply saying an artificial brain, like Kurzweil would say. Cosmos are those of the cosmos. These are the ones who are going to want to build the artificial intelligence. Terrans, terra of the earth, terra firma, that's people like us who say, wait a minute, really, is this a good idea? And what Hugo de Garis says is that the conflict that will arise overnight, there will be a civil war, will ultimately rapidly spread into the Third World War, and before the end of the 21st century, there will be billions of dead humanity. In fact, according to Hugo de Garis, all life on Earth will be annihilated as a result of what he yet says, something is pushing him, something's behind him, something's pressing him, Russ, something's forcing him, something's whispering in his ear, something's got him by the neck saying, you have to create this, you have to open this gateway, you have to open this doorway, we have to come through. And I think he's a prophet. And I agree with Hugo de Garis. I believe that we are moving toward a period of time, and if you read here, I dare you, read the Artelect War without thinking about Armageddon. Try to do it. It is prophetic, because there is a coming moment in which the anti-human forces are going to align themselves against everything that is God and godly, and on the other side of that rift, there will be an army. Hallelujah. That's been a long time since I said hallelujah. I almost got goose pimples over there. And I know what side I intend to be on. Okay, so it's prophetic. I agree with him. I agree with the Jasons. I agree we're going to run out of time here in a minute. But I also believe now from my worldview that essentially what we are describing here today in all of these lectures and in this lecture We are describing the fulfillment of biblical prophecy. We are not unaware that this day should come upon us as a snare. When Jesus' closest disciples said, "Lord, tell us, what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the aeon, the end of the age?" And he gave them that list that everybody's been talking about today. Wars and rumors of wars and the seas and the waves raging. All of the signs in the skies and in the heavens. And then he said, as Matthew 24, 37, "As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man." What was it that so marked the days of Noah? There's really only one thing that really stands out in the days of Noah. This was when the transhuman geneticists known as the Watchers descended in the days of Jared, according to 1 Enoch, which Jude and Peter quote in the New Testament either as history or as canon. I'll leave you to decide which. The Watchers came down in the days of Jared. They descended down in the Valley of the Plain. I noticed earlier when Sharon Gilbert said they took wives of all which they would, they married them. First of all, it was more like rape and abduction than it was anything else. And that's what those forces always do. But then if you do what I've done, by the time I wrote Apollyon Rising 2012, I had almost 7,000 pages of research. I went back and found every ancient document I could put my hands on that told this story. And it is global. It's worldwide. It's within every culture. And the story was consistent. Not only did they use the DNA of humans, but they sinned against the animals. And even the Bible says that the flood came as a result of all flesh having been corrupted, both man and beast. And you have to keep in mind that it can't then mean corruption in the sense of immorality, because we do not assign immorality to animals. If you're in Africa and you run out into a field and get eaten by a lion, sorry, Charlie, the lion didn't do it because it was immoral. It didn't even do it because it was malevolent. It did it because it's a predator, and in this fallen state, that's what lions do. So don't run out into an open field. But in this biblical text, all flesh had become corrupted. You cannot then soundly, theologically, ascribe that to mean immorality. It was something else. It was corruption. It was DNA degradation. And as a result of what occurred, God sends this flood. Now, I also have a theory, by the way, about why they had to blend animals and humans, and I don't know if I have enough time to say it. I could say it in my very fast voice. I could make your ears hear me quicker. Probably better not. Okay, we'll leave that for another time. Okay, very quickly. I was kind of pulling just to see if you were still with me. Why would Watchers blend animals and humans and create it? What was the point behind it? So first of all, I had to go back and ask myself, what was their motive? What was it that the Watchers wanted to do? And according to all the texts, including Peter and John, their motive was to leave their plane of existence. They wanted to leave their habitation. Those angels which kept not their first estate, but left their habitation, God hath reserved in everlasting chains of darkness, awaiting the judgment of the great day. Their motive was they wanted to leave their plane of existence. Okay, that's what they wanted to do. Now, how would blending animals and humans facilitate that? Well, see, many years ago, for a 3-year period, we write about this, by the way, and even tell some of the stories from that era. My wife and I were involved with a group of about 45 people in exorcism. And I learned back in those days that you could cast the alien spirits out of an individual, but one thing you could never do was cast that person's innate spirit out of them. You are you till the day you die. What man knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of man that is within him? That spirit is put in you at the moment of conception, and it's in you till the day you die. Now, you could become demon-possessed, or better, you could have the spirit of God. You can have the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, residing within you. But your spirit cannot be separated from your body till the day that you die and you go back to be with God. Well, now, this was a problem for the Watchers, because the Watchers didn't just want to come down to earth like fallen angels and possess a human or an animal and get in there with your spirit. That ain't what they wanted. They wanted incarnation. And the problem was God had spoke everything into creation. Everything, every animal, every being, every humans, it all went back to God, who alone, Bara, could speak and by the authority of the power of his voice, call forth out of nothingness raw atomic nuclear power, and he could bring it forth and bring it together, put it together in different atomic constructs and molecular form, so that he made the dog and he put the nature of a dog in it, and he made a human and he breathes into the human. God alone had the power to do that. None of the angel class could do that. And then after he set it in motion, he said, and every kind recreates after its own kind, and he put the walls, the barriers up. And this was to protect all of us in the animal kingdom too. The watchers didn't like that. They couldn't get the spirit of a human out of a human. What were they going to do? Well, one thing they could do, they couldn't speak into existence like God could, but they could sure do what our genetic scientists are doing today. They could corrupt genetics. They could take the genotypes of animals and the genetics of humans. They could blend them, and they could create something that fell outside of the divine order. Now the particular nature of an animal wouldn't enter into it before it wasn't a particular animal. The spirit of a human wouldn't enter into it at the point of its creation before it wasn't a human. It was simply a raw, a biological construct into which they could extend themselves. And I came to believe that that is the testimony of what they did, and that is why instantaneously they were irredeemable and they came under the judgment of God. And God said to the Israelites, if you see a Nephilim, kill it on the spot. Here's an amazing thing, that everything we know about God is that he is long-suffering. He is patient. Even in the Hebraic laws of the Old Testament, they had to have a provision for people to come in from the outside to become, if you will, in the Old Testament sense, saved. Not the Nephilim. And if you read the first book of Enoch, the angels, they're all pleading to God. Is there any chance? And he says, not for them. There is no redemption for them. And the Raphaim, here's another startling thing. The Raphaim, their name means to be healed, as in a resurrection. And yet Isaiah says of them, they shall not rise. Now, wait a minute. Here's a mystery. They can be healed as in a resurrection, but they shall not rise. Another mystery that I had to wrestle over. I finally came to believe that what it was saying was, they will not participate in the glorious resurrection that you and I are going to get, because I already asked God for it and God already told them no. They will not receive a new glorified body and return to God to live in heaven forever like we will, but they can be healed from death. There is a method by which they can extend themselves into another corruptible form. Now the mystery really deepens. Because God judged the watchers. The flood comes, wipes them all out. Hardly had the ark settled at Ararat and the waters receded, generations begin developing upon earth, and guess what? We're back. Now, how did that happen? How did they come back? This is a real mystery. We don't have a record that some more watchers came down and created some more. I think the watchers probably said, that was a really bad idea. We're staying here. That didn't happen. How does that happen? Now, how does that happen? Is it a David Icke bloodline? Icky, if you don't know the alternate term. He don't like being called Icky. The bloodline of the Antichrist. Where at some point, somehow reptilian DNA is somehow reintroduced to the tribe of Dan, out of which the Antichrist will come? Sharon, is it this, what do we call it, junk DNA? What is this junk DNA? It's coded to do something, evidently. We don't know what it's coded for. Are those idling trucks that you referred to? I wish I could say that language like you do. I've read it. I've tried to memorize it so I can get up and sound like I know something. Are they getting ready to dump their payload? They have. They begin in both of the last two books. You don't know this, by the way, but we took the information you wrote for Apollyon Rising 2012, that segment, and put it in Forbidden Gates, too, because it applied. I knew I didn't have to tell you that sometime. I'll tell you here. That way you can't get mad at me for not asking. They've already dumped their payload. It's already there. Now, see, you could say, the point that I'm making is this, by the way, that there has to be a method for them to come back. They did, After the flood. After the judgment. They came back again. The Samsusan, the Anakim. Somebody's got some kind of a ice cream machine playing in their purse. They came back. When the leaders of Israel go down into Canaan, and we saw the sons of Anak there, which come of the giants, they came back. They come of the Nephilim. How do they come back? There has to be a method. There has to be a way. And what's also frightening is there is prophecy, I believe, that they're going to, and they're going to come in large hordes. Isaiah 13, if you read it in the Greek Septuagint, says, "Open the gate, ye ruler. I give command, and I bring them. Giants are coming to fulfill my wrath." This is a future prophecy. Giants are coming. The Giborim, the offspring of the Nephilim, are coming to fulfill my wrath. They have some way of coming back. And I think, by the way, that there is an example of this happening. I believe that there is an example of this in the book of Genesis, chapter 10, verse 8, I believe. It says, "And Cush begat Nimrod, and he began to be a mighty." And the phrase there in the Hebrew, "began to be," is halal, which means sexual or genetic degradation. And by the way, Russ, it also carries with it the sense that there could be like an occult process here happening. Like we're having some form of a ritual that then sets in motion this genetic degradation. A very fascinating study. Well, Nimrod began to be a mighty, which is the Hebrew word Gibora, of which we make the Giborim, the offspring of the Nephilim. Now that's an amazing, fascinating Old Testament portion of Scripture. Cush begat Nimrod, and he began to be a Giborim. Now put this in science as we understand it. Not very long ago, about 3 or 4 years ago, I began to be a diabetic. It didn't mean that I would, but I had the heritable gene related to some kind of malfunction in the production of insulin. And as a result of the way I was living my life, and those of you looking at me saying, yeah, a Twinkie a day keeps the doctor away, but that's not what was happening. Honestly, in fact, my kids will tell you, I'm the runt of all the men in my family. My granddad was a giant man. My dad and brother are much bigger than me. And actually, I eat less than anybody in my family, including my kids, including the slave. Look at his fine physique. What I was doing is I'd get up in the morning and I wouldn't eat until 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon sometimes. If I'm throwing off my blood sugar and everything, well, I triggered whatever this is. And it started, and guess what? It started changing me genetically. It started altering me. It started changing me into something that I wasn't before. And it's very powerful. The metabolic changes that are occurring within my system now can kill me if I don't take very powerful drugs to try to moderate my blood sugar. But up until that moment, I wasn't a diabetic. And then I began to be. And I often wondered about Nimrod. What was there about Nimrod? Was there something in his blood? Was there a genetic inherent? Was it the idling trucks? Was it junk DNA? Did he come in contact with some kind of occultism, Russ, that then caused his genetics? Whatever happened, he started becoming a fit extension. The interesting thing about Genesis 6:4, the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, but in the Greek Septuagint, which is the translation of the Hebrew Old Testament, it says they saw the daughters of men that they were fit extensions. And keep in mind, they wanted to leave their plane of reality, so they found a fit extension, a method, a mechanism, which they could use to create a construct they could use to bring themselves into our reality. I believe Nimrod and prophetic utterances tell us that it could happen again. It may be part of the army of Armageddon. And I really honestly am going to make myself go really fast here because I don't even know what time I started and I don't know what time it is now. So I'm going to make myself finish. There are some other signs of the days of Noah. And I'll say this in conclusion. And the entire last section of our new book, Forbidden Gates, deals with this. These are the signs we can get excited about. Because I'm like everybody else, you know, when we talk about the days of Noah, I'm always focusing on these giants that are going to come back, or the spirit of the Nephilim. But there were other signs of the days of Noah. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And as everything else went down in the seas of destruction, Noah survived. And Peter says that Noah became a preacher of righteousness. I am on a quest to find preachers of righteousness, because they possess the power before which the spirit of the Nephilim cannot stand. Can you imagine the days of Noah? The Bible says that not just the fallen angels, but the intents of people's hearts, the thoughts of their mind, was only evil continuously. He was surrounded by nothing but spiritual forces that would have destroyed him. Well, how did he survive? He found grace. Grace doesn't just mean forgiveness and salvation. He was protected. There was a wall of divine armor around him that allowed him in his day, when the thoughts and intents of people's hearts was towards darkness, to be a preacher of righteousness. And he prevailed. Then, after the flood, here they come back again. But guess what? You got a little runt of a ruddy by the name of David who goes down, and Goliath is paralyzing all of the armies of Israel. And what does he say? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should challenge the armies of the living God? And he runs at him. That had to be a shocker and an insult to the cowardly brothers, right? I mean, me, I'm like strategic. I'm getting behind a tree. I'm calling on my brothers for help. He runs at him and takes him down. Well, you know the rest of the story. Well, that's it. That's a young guy. I'm looking for such young preachers of righteousness today who believe that we outnumber them. Who are they to define for us who we are? We can always be God's champions. Always. But I notice a little gray hair here, so for you, earlier than that, Israel arrives at Canaan. And boy, I know, Russ, you were a pastor. Are there other pastors or preachers here? Oh, let me tell you, there. If you haven't preached it already, there is some great preaching here. Fantastic preaching. Where the children of Israel, they get to the land of Canaan. Moses selects 12 spies. He sends them into the land of Canaan. They go down by the brook Eshcol. They cut down this giant thing of grapes and put it on a staff, put it between two shoulders. They come back. And then they start giving their report. And what is it that the 10 spies of the 12, what is it that they say? First of all, they pretend that they're people of faith. Pretenders always do this. Yep, we went up there. Boy, it was everything God said it was going to be. But nevertheless, there are some walled cities there. There are giants in the land, big honkers. And we are not able to overcome them. Listen to what they said, though. We became as grasshoppers in their sight, and so we were. See, that's my problem with Patrick Lynn or anybody else at the IEET telling me who I am and what I am and what I represent. I just really don't like somebody else telling me what I am or what I believe or how big my God is. I almost started preaching. I'm sorry. We became as grasshoppers in their sight, and so we were. You know, the Bible says, as a man believeth in his heart, so is he. Psalm 78 says, and they limited the Holy One of Israel. They made God so small that he became the God of the grasshopper people. But what did Joshua and Caleb do? We are more than able. And you know what's great, without telling the whole story, because I promised I'd shut up, is that God gets sick of them. They're whispering. He tells Moses, they're whispering in my ear, night and day, day and night. God brought us up into the wilderness to let us die. But God believed in positive, name it and claim it. Because he says to Moses, they named it, now they're going to claim it. They're all going to die. From the age of 20 years old and upward, they will not inherit this land. Their bones will bleach white in the sand, and they will not inherit this land. But that generation dies, and then what does God do? He says, can somebody tell me where Joshua and Caleb is? Hey, you still ready to go up? And here is Caleb, and if my memory serves me correctly, he is pushing 90 years of age. I think he's 87 years of age, and he goes up into Canaan, and he drives out the sons of Anak. And he possesses the land. That too is a sign related to those spirits of the Nephilim that date back to the days of the watchers. One other one, very quickly, not all the angels fell. That too is a sign of the days of Noah. As a matter of fact, only 200 did. How many watchers are there? I bet there's a whole lot more than 200. There are more that are for us than those that are against us. Even if you add the book of Revelation, and his tail drew one third of the stars of heaven. There's still, well, first of all, several points. There's at least two times as many on our side as those who are against us. Secondly, God can make as many as he wants. If he needs more, he'll just make them. And thirdly, when you detach yourself from God, do you gain in power or do you lose power? So the ones we got are already more powerful. And they'll set 10,000 to flight. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for letting me come here today and talk to you. Privileged to be with you. God bless you.